the last video, we saw how dinosaurs flourished during Jurassic times. Now let's dive into the last and longest period of the Mesozoic era, the Cretaceous period. By the end of this time, 66 million years ago, dinosaurs will be extinct. We continue our journey where we left off, at Dinosaur Ridge, a well-known site within the Morris and Golden Fossil Area's National Natural Landmark. There is a section here that contains Cretaceous-age dinosaur tracks. Let's look at them now.
If you look very closely with a trained eye or an untrained eye, things start to pop out at you. And right over here to the left of me, this feature, what does that look like?
Dinosaur track.
Toes?
Most definitely. That's a three-toed dinosaur.
Some things that we can learn from dinosaur tracks that we can't learn from fossils would be how the animal moved. Were their arms right underneath them? Were their arms splayed out to the side? How fast were they moving? What direction were they going? You can tell a lot about the soft anatomy of their feet and hands, like what their little toe pads would have looked like. Sometimes you can even see their skin. You can tell behaviors, like crouching down to get a drink, or were they bending over to get a drink? We actually have fossils of animals squatting down to drink water. We see swimming traces for all different kinds of animals. So you can learn a lot from trackways that you just can't tell from a dinosaur bone.
Okay, so there's a nice three-toed print, this whole thing, this whole complex. So what happened is the dinosaurs, they weren't walking up a hill. This was a flat beach or something like that at the time. The dinosaurs walked, and then sooner or later, you know, like on a typical monsoonal afternoon, you know, maybe a storm brews up, blows in a lot of rain and mud and all sorts of other stuff. And the mud quickly covers these dinosaur tracks and fills them in, where then 100 million years later, they become exposed to the elements of erosion and they re-expose these tracks that were made on that day. Because normally when you're walking along the beach, you know, you're walking along, you turn around, your tracks are gone as soon as the wind moves the current or the water comes in, whatever. But that little layer that represents a little mud deposit from a storm or something was able to preserve these tracks right in this layer.
The Morris and Golden fossil sites also consist of a wall of Cretaceous-age plant and animal impressions at the Colorado School of Mines. There are also Triceratops tracks along the Triceratops Trail tucked among the Fossil Trace Golf Course. Let's zoom forward in time near the end of the Cretaceous when the Hell Creek Formation was deposited. This formation contains near-complete skeletons of what is probably the most well-known dinosaur, the Tyrannosaurus rex.
The dinosaurs that we find in the Hell Creek are very different from the dinosaurs that we find in the Morrison Formation, for instance, in Utah or Colorado.
The Hell Creek Formation can be found in parts of Montana, North Dakota, and South Dakota. To recognize the amazing fossils found within this formation, the Hell Creek Fossil Area National Natural Landmark was designated in 1966. Over 95% of T-Rex museum specimens have come from this area. Let's travel there now. Greg Liggett, a paleontologist for the Bureau of Land Management, tells us more about this formation and the cool things you can find at this one-of-a-kind site.
When the Hell Creek was deposited, Montana was coastal property. Sediments were washing in off of the shoreline into the remnants of what we call the Late Cretaceous Interior Seaway. So in other words, it was along the shore. The Hell Creek Formation is significant scientifically for many reasons. One of the things that stands out is the quality of the fossils that it preserves. It preserves not just dinosaurs like Tyrannosaurus or Triceratops, but it also preserves plants and recently some insects, amphibians, reptiles, fish, mammals. So in other words, it captures a whole ecosystem at the time of when the dinosaurs were going extinct.
While not within the designated landmark boundary, a nearby active dig being conducted by the Burke Museum gives us a real-life glimpse into what makes this area so special.
Most of the bones are sort of in their anatomical placement, even though they're disarticulated. You get the head here, you got some of the neck bones here, and the lower jaw. This is the inside of the backbone of a rex, and it's very typical honeycomb shape.
we know how rapidly the sediments in this area accumulate. So we can say, okay, the T-Rex is 66.02 million years old, plus whatever thickness of sediments below that corresponds to. So my guess is that it'll be 66.5 or 6 million years old, which will be on the young end of T-Rexes. It's one of the last ones around.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Little did the T-Rex know that a large meteorite would hit Earth and trigger a mass extinction, wiping out a majority of the world's Mesozoic species, including all dinosaurs except for birds. This planet-altering episode that occurred 66 million years ago is referred to as the Cretaceous-Paleogene extinction event, and is exceptionally well represented at the West Bijou Site NNL in northeast Colorado. It is captured in the fossil record by a thin band of rock known as the KPG boundary, which physically separates the time before and after the dinosaurs. The KPG boundary signifies the end of the Cretaceous period and the beginning of a new era, the Cenozoic. Wow, what a journey! Over this series of three videos, we have traveled through three geologic periods covering 185 million years, explored six NNL sites within four different states along the Rocky Mountain front, all while learning about the Mesozoic era, that cool time in Earth's history when dinosaurs reigned. This is just one of the many stories America's natural places have to tell, and every one of us can play a role in helping to protect these sites and share their stories.
Well, fossils are really the only window we have into the deep past history of life.
I want to bring my grandkids here someday, and I want the fossils to still be here.
Just anybody visiting a site can become a scientist by looking around, observing the fossils that you might see, taking notes, and then you can report that back to a museum or to your local park office.
Scientists will come in and restudy, and they'll look at some of those same bones and find new information that just is totally surprising.
It's not just a matter of collecting a new dinosaur to put it in the drawer. It's answering a new question and adding to our knowledge that we have already.
We might be just at the beginning of what we actually can know.